colleagues, and thank you for the invitation. I'm going to try to provide a broad overview of combination prevention, sort of insights to introduce the topic or to see where we are with it. What are the key ideas I want to focus on in this occasion? HIV prevention has historically meant for, and until recently, behavioral change. That was condom use, abstinence, and monogamy. Important achievements in biomedical prevention have, however, happened over the past decade. That is changing our landscape. And there's also an increasingly recognized need of enabling environments, leading to what we have called structural interventions. So we have created this concept probably almost over a decade ago of combination HIV prevention, which has been over the past 2 or 3 years linked with another concept, the continuum of prevention and care, which is related to achieving viral suppression with individual and community benefit. Biomedical components of combination prevention have raised certain questions, particularly PrEP, related to feasibility, efficiency, risk compensation, ethics, etc. But of course, there's evidence of efficacy. So, and the other phenomenon we have faced is that we are still seeing some apathetic or even hostile responses among some stakeholders. In fact, the combination prevention concept remains somewhat vague, and we feel it should mean integration of effective old and new strategies. The main contribution of the combination is the synergy, and we should use evidence and tools, for example, modeling, to do it better. We have to recognize that that combination prevention implies a major shift in a 25-year-old prevention paradigm, where we're moving from this concept that we have so much in our minds about 100% condom use, which defined both individual and community ethics, and we're moving to a new paradigm that is more nuanced and flexible, where flexibility is a technical strength, but it is also a hermeneutic, a communicational weakness. Can this transition be regarded as less oppositional and more integrative? We need to continue to work in the development of this concept of combination prevention and need to go from opposition to integration. So, we've seen this graph several times before. Definitely, combination prevention was first presented, I think, in 2010. I was in charge of speaking about combination prevention in plenary in Vienna, and many things have happened since. Definitely, a much more, I would say, orderly concept of combination came with the AIDS investment framework by UNAIDS, because they pointed out biomedical and behavioral interventions within the inner white square with different kinds of interventions. But then they were able to include structural interventions focused on critical enablers, both of a social nature and of a programmatic nature. And also, we look at the bottom of the slide, at synergies with development sectors. So defining combination prevention is definitely has been a challenge. The UNAIDS Prevention Reference Group first defined it as a rights-based, evidence-informed, community-owned set of programs, I mean, including the biomedical, behavioral, structural. They need to prioritize according to individual needs. Interventions that had the greatest sustained impact on reducing incidence. and also tailored to national and local needs and conditions. Now, at least we may think of two approaches to thinking combination. A more traditional one in HIV programming has been related to different prevention models per population. You know, for MSM, you had one approach, for sex workers, another, etc. Now, new combination thinking probably is related to both individual and structural elements. Brings us to think that within a population we have different options. You know, some people may use condoms, others PrEP, others may rely on viral suppression, others may use seroadaptation, perhaps, and even for each individual there are variations over time. Now, new technologies such as test and offer play a key role. HTLC, HIV testing linked to care, is a program that makes us focus on ensuring that more people are diagnosed and treated earlier. It's acceptable, especially in the context of serodiscordant couples. And there's a global trend to treatment for all levels of CD4. I mean, WHO is probably going to recommend that very soon. Now, their bar is related to health systems. The substantially increased testing and the elimination of ARV supply shortages. What happens with PrEP, which is going to be a big star in this conference probably? Now, we are competing with sessions on PrEP now, you know that. There's great resistance among the various actors still. And of course, there are obstacles, such as the need to adapt health systems and monitoring to define access in relation to cost, funding, and cost benefit, the dimension, the commercial dimension, but also many strange ideological barriers that we need to study more, no? From different points of view. What doctors think about the resistance or programmatic thinking with even its moral components there, and what even the community may feel, no? Confusion with treatment, stigma, concern about competition with real treatment. However, why it might be helpful now? No? If adherence is reasonably high, effectiveness may be very high, picked by people for whom condoms are not a solution. It's something we saw in PROUD among MSM in the UK, no? A group with 9% incidence, already low condom use, who showed very good adherence. And of course, there's a global trend where unfortunately condom use continues to fall. PrEP also offers protection to some people as a temporary measure because it's not necessarily thought as something that people have to use forever. I mean, on the contrary. And also, we need to remember that preventions bring individual and community benefits. And in some cases, we have to pay significant attention to the community benefits too, and stop worrying about, I mean, why this person is not responsible enough and not using condoms. I mean, definitely, we have to look not at isolated infections, but at the possibility of more people getting infected too. Well, the other big component of combination prevention, of course, is structural approaches linked to the WHO work on social determinants of health. And there's a definition of social drivers as core special processes and arrangements reflective of social and cultural norms, values, networks, structures, and institutions that operate around and in concert with individual behaviors and practices to influence HIV epidemics in particular settings. Definitely, structural approaches generally address factors that depend on the state, no? Even affect global agreements, affect individual life conditions, affect their options, no? And we can talk about those of them that are ameliorative, no? For example, improving access, more proximal, and those that are more distal, more fundamental, for example, improving education. What happened What about the notion of paradigms? We probably heard about Thomas Kuhn, this famous physicist and historian who wrote about the structure of scientific revolutions. And this concept of paradigm was extremely useful in the philosophy of science, as it tried to reflect the shared background, common sense, based on consensual scientific axioms, no? So that we had periods of broad consensus where a paradigm was clearly dominant, and periods of paradigm crisis. Paradigm shifts occurred when the dominant paradigm no longer explained reality, and he was very graphic explaining the changes in his field in physics, from the Ptolemaic to the Copernican to the Newtonian to the relativistic paradigm. You should read that book, it's a very interesting one. So in HIV science, not talking about, scientific paradigms, but about, action paradigms. The prevention paradigm we lived with for two decades was safer sex, condoms, abstinence, and to some extent abstinence and monogamy. And here, definitely we had achievements, and what happens in combination prevention. We had a climax, but any a decay in the paradigm of safer sex. Definitely, we never achieved 100% condom use, and when ARVT arose, the momentum was definitely lost. We also know that condomless sex has been eroticized. No, you may those of you who explore the internet may have found this famous Bellamy gay porn, where the label of condom-free has become one of the main attractions, and it happens all over in gay porn over the internet. So condomless sex is the big attraction, and clearly it will have an effect on people. There are difficulties inherent to combination prevention, and we have to, it's more real, so it's more complex. It reflects the need to include all, new technology, reinvigorating testing and condoms, acknowledgement of the role of the structural, and acknowledgement even of what the communities themselves created, no? Harm reduction approaches such as zero adaptation. We still have to realize that many people know very little in most of the countries about, for example, PrEP, and their signs of resistance to paradigm shift. This graph here is about actually a website in Mexico recommending people to zero sort, no, as one option. Have fun and reduce risks. There are many graphs that can show the importance of looking at several dimensions in prevention. And we also have to remember that time has a role, plays a role. There are interventions where changes are immediate and interventions where change takes much longer. No, and also, there's a difference between effectiveness and efficacy, and structural factors are crucial there. No? For example, in the cascade, clearly there are many elements, social elements to take into account. And it also happened with voluntary male medical circumcision, where in Africa, uptake was very diverse across countries. In Peru, we did a study. We're conducting, finalizing a study, mixed methods, trying to focus on trans women who do sex work. And they are clearly, we use this with Imperial College London, with our colleagues, deterministic model that had been developed before to check potential combinations of interventions. This was, for example, five interventions plus a structural component that we tested: condom use with clients, condom use with stable partners, test and offer, PrEP, and treatment at CD4 less than 500, to upgrade to the current WHO guidelines. And definitely what we found was that just combining treatment with improved condom use, we could reach the UNGAS goal of 50%. I mean, we're now talking about different goal, but we had little control of treatment adherence, and even less so of increases in condom use. And with PrEP, we could do better. But of course, the possibility of PrEP being used depended on the possibility of reducing costs, which implied the negotiation, and also on much better planning and organization of systems. No, that's something that was very important in our study, and we'll present our results very, very soon. Just to reaffirm that condom-based prevention is insufficient. Combination prevention, in theory, it's more nuanced, but presents difficulties that need to be addressed. It has not been easily accepted. Combination prevention, however, has not been easily accepted as progress, and many people feel it's just a strategy to sell PrEP. And so we need to do additional conceptual work, no? Combination prevention demonstration projects, perhaps, and more communication. Just to announce that in the next session, a special issue of JAYAS is going to be released, among other things, in a press conference announced by the International Society. No, and NEMUS is a project that provides information on multidisciplinary studies on ARV-based HIV prevention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Carlos. Our next speaker, Andrew Gerlich, is a professor, head of HIV epidemiology and prevention at the Kirby Institute, the University of New South Wales. His team investigates links between infection, immunity, and cancer, and in recent years, the main focus of his work on cancer